They're coming to get you, Barbara.
In 1968, George A. Romero created the modern zombie film with Night of the Living Dead, a modest horror movie shot on 35mm black and white film and made on a shoestring budget. A handful of local and amateur actors gathered at a farmhouse in Butler County, Pennsylvania to shoot the directorial debut of a man whose resume was limited largely to working on the set of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. The film practically defines amateur. Shot compositions are often awkwardly framed, line delivery is commonly stilted.
Stop it! You're ignorant!
And special effects are limited to the makeup that untrained actors could apply to each other using not much more than animal guts and household products. That said, there really was nothing like it at the time, and in understanding the importance of Night of the Living Dead, and Romero's films as a whole, it's important to look at their placement in history. At the time of Night's release, horror films were, for the most part, spooky goosebump stories seen by kids dropped off at the drive-in movie theater by their parents for the evening. But Night of the Living Dead shifted the genre into adult territory. Critic Roger Ebert famously wrote a review of the film in which he did not assign it a star rating, but wrote, "The kids in the audience were stunned. The movie had stopped being delightfully scary about halfway through and had become unexpectedly terrifying. There was a little girl across the aisle from me, maybe 9 years old, who was sitting very still in her seat and crying." The film was brutal, humorless, and violent, but more than that, it felt wholly relevant. Romero aimed to create a biting political satire about the decade in which it was made, because, as Romero has often put it, the 60s just didn't work. The story, in which the victims were just normal, average people living in a rural town, embodied the growing feelings of paranoia, fear, and restrictions of rights encroaching upon the life of the American everyman in the midst of the Cold War in Vietnam. Although the film's supposed racial message was unintentional and dependent on a simple casting choice, the film felt nonetheless relevant. Its stark visuals and comparatively brutal violence, coupled with an ending that defied all film convention at the time, made it a horror classic. Classic though it was, in many minds, including my own, Night was easily beaten out by its sequel, 1979's Dawn of the Dead. Romero had never intended to make a sequel to his iconic film, but a decade after the original's release, Romero walked into Pennsylvania's Monroeville Mall and had an idea. Indoor malls were a relatively new and growing enterprise in the US. To Romero, they represented a shrine to out-of-control American consumerism, a veritable altar to habitual spending and mindless materialism. Dawn of the Dead was much more thematically focused than his predecessor. I mean, I can't imagine what point is trying to be made by this subtle image. The movie was funny and had plenty of levity to contrast with its grotesque violence, made possible with the help of practical gore effects deity Tom Savini, although the grayish-blue paint on all of the zombies just looks silly. The performances are excellent, and the film smartly eschewed horror for a solid 25% of the movie, in which the zombies are purged from the mall and the characters are left to fight the worst monster of all. Their own humanity! In 1985, Romero released the third film in his Dead series, Day of the Dead. Day eschewed Dawn's humor and fun for an even darker and grittier story that was Romero's attempt at a more thoughtful and meditative horror film. Though initially panned upon its release, Day has recently gathered a following of fans who appreciate the film without the weighty expectations of following Dawn. What do I think about it? It's okay. Romero's eye for photography clearly developed since Dawn, and Tom Savini's practical gore effects are downright jaw-dropping, holding up surprisingly well 3 decades after its release. Its ending is one of the best hitting-the-fan endings ever, in which the zombies breach the bunker in which the protagonists are hiding out. Unfortunately, the story's message ultimately feels less focused and the characters are mostly horror mainstays that are not particularly interesting, with the exception of one. Fucking Bub! The first sentient zombie and easily the best character in the movie, by far. But other than Bub, good God is the overacting in this movie egregious. Everyone is so over the top that it's impossible to take them seriously most of the time.
I'm running this monkey farm now, Frankenstein, and I want to know what the fuck you're doing with my time!
What probably would have been the film's one really good performance is all but ruined by a really bad West Indian accent.
He visited a curse on us. So we might get a look at what hell was like.
So ultimately, the movie is kind of a mixed bag. It's not bad, but it's not great either. Now I'm going to rewind to Romero's film before Dawn of the Dead, 1977's Martin, Romero's cult classic contribution to the vampire subgenre. Sort of. Interestingly, the film never really tells you whether or not its titular character is actually a vampire. What it does show you is a deeply disturbed teenager with the unsavory habit of drugging women, stripping them down to nothing, slitting their wrists, and drinking their blood. As impossible as it might seem to have any sympathy for a character who gets their sick jollies in such a fucked up manner, Romero crafts one of his more thoughtful and meditative films about a young man struggling with profound loneliness and intimacy issues, sent to live with his uncle, a conservative traditionalist Catholic, seeking to purge Martin of his vampirism.
Nosferatu.
It doesn't make Martin's actions any easier to swallow, but John Amplis' performance and Romero's script make the character into something more than a monster. Some shot compositions are a tad awkward, but visually the film makes good use of its setting. Some people expecting a terrifying horror film from one of the masters of the genre may be a tad disappointed by the film's somewhat odd pacing and leaning towards a tragic drama rather than a horror film, but as a whole, Martin represents an interesting departure from one of the most daring and iconic filmmakers in horror history.
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
They're coming to get you, Barbara. They're coming.